So now I'd like you to welcome our board of directors member, Tracy Mulroy.
Thank you, Melissa. On behalf of the OIF board of directors, I am honored to introduce this illustrious panel on adult health. OIF adult health is a particular passion of mine, especially after losing one of my best friends, Jamie Kendall, to a respiratory issue. The Jamie Kendall Fund has raised over $500,000 in conducting research on OI adult health issues, particularly pulmonary and cardiac issues, which have yet to be fully understood, but which we're making great progress in. And I'd like to now introduce our speakers and panelists. Our speaker is Dr. Sandesh Nagamani, and he is a clinical geneticist at Baylor who provides clinical care for adult patients with a wide variety of heritable conditions, including OI. He is a lead investigator for the Brittle Bones Disorders Consortium and on the Medical Advisory Committee. Our panelists are Dr. Mahim Jain, who is a member of the OI Clinic at the Kennedy Krieger Institute in Baltimore with a specialty in endocrinology, and he provides care for OI adults, among others. Secondly, we have Dr. Eric Rush, who is a clinical geneticist at the University of Kansas Medical Center. OI is one of Dr. Rush's primary interests. Thirdly, we have Dr. Robert Sandy Sandhaus, who is a pulmonologist at National Jewish Health in Denver. I had the privilege of serving on the board of directors with Sandy many years ago, and he is currently a member of the Medical Advisory Committee and has been particularly instrumental in guiding the foundation and OI patients through the COVID pandemic. Fourth, we have Dr. Laura Tosi, who is an orthopedist at Children's Hospital in Washington, D.C., but spends an enormous amount of her time on OI adult issues. She currently serves on the board of directors of the OI Foundation, and she chairs the Medical Advisory Board. Dr. Vernick provides state-of-the-art care to patients with ear, nose, and throat problems. He is skilled in the use of lasers for treatment of OI hearing loss, and is a member of the OIF Medical Advisory Committee. Just to say how this is gonna work a little bit, Dr. Nagamani is gonna speak for about 15 to 20 minutes with an update on the latest in OI adult health. And then we will open it up to questions for our panelists. Not every specialty is covered here, but please feel free to ask anything, and our esteemed panelists will either try to answer or steer you in the right direction. Dental and women's health issues are broken out into their own sessions because there's such a demand for those two issues. So please look and see when those programs are scheduled if you're interested. Before we get started, we'd like to share a video message from our sponsor for this session, the Kennedy Krieger Institute in Baltimore, Maryland.
Hi, I'm Mahim Jain, director of the Osteogenesis Infirmary Program at Kennedy Krieger Institute. Affecting over 50,000 people in the United States alone, Osteogenesis Imperfecta is a genetic disorder characterized by abnormally brittle bones. The Osteogenesis Imperfecta, or OI, at Kennedy Krieger Institute, is dedicated to caring for and improving the lives of children and adults with OI. To address the complex indications of osteogenesis, Kennedy Krieger deploys an interdisciplinary team comprised of medical and orthopedic specialists, physical therapists, behavior psychologists, and pain management professionals. This team of experts ensures a thorough evaluation of the patients and individuals. We are motivated and dedicated to improve function and treat chronic pain for the adults with OI using non-opioid treatment. We are developing personalized high-throughput models of bone ambassadors with the goal of optimizing medical treatments for adults with osteogenesis. We welcome patients with OI of all ages. For more information, visit kennedykrieger.org/OI.
Thank you again so much to the Kennedy Krieger Institute for sponsoring this. During the commercial break, I was informed that Dr. Nagamani is actually going to be speaking for 30 minutes. So I apologize for that and just wanted to make sure everybody was prepared. So now let's turn it over to Dr. Nagamani.
Thank you very much, Ms. Mulroy, and thanks to everyone for joining. Many thanks to the OIF for the opportunity to talk to all of you about some of the care-related issues that we have in adults. So I'll try to rush through the talk because of the limited time we have and the amount that I have to cover, but if there are parts that need clarification, please bring that up in the question and answer session. So these are my disclosures. I do conduct clinical trials and studies and collaborations with partners.
Dr. Nagamani, sorry to interrupt. Oh, you don't seem to be sharing your screen.
Thank you. I thought I was. That was my bad. Is it visible now?
No.
Let me do that again.
I see it.
Oh, here it comes. Yep, okay. There you go.
So now you can see it?
Yes, we're all good. Thank you.
Perfect. Okay, so start again. So these are my disclosures. While I do conduct clinical trials and studies and collaborations with the partners in the pharmaceutical industry pertaining to OI and other rare skeletal disorders, I do not have any consulting agreements or any financial conflicts to disclose. I will mention some of the medications that are used in OI. All of this is published data, and I will use only generic forms. So I tried to break down the talk into these four parts so that we could address all the adult care-related issues. Part one is to understand what are indeed the issues in adults with OI. I'm going to talk about patient perspectives that you guys have participated in, including filling out the surveys and doing the health-related quality of life measures and registry-based data. The second and third part are going to be what are actually the medical related issues for OI, the skeletal and extraskeletal issues. And finally, I'll just go to what we would suggest for transition of care and for continuity of care in adults with OI. So I don't need to tell any of you what OI is. All of you have lived experiences of the disorder. It is a genetic disorder, Mendelian disorder, estimated to have a prevalence of 1 in 15,000 live births. OI is a skeletal disease that presents with low bone mass, recurrent fractures on skeletal deformities, as shown on the x-rays right here. But OI is also much more than just involving bone. It has extraskeletal features. You can have abnormalities of teeth, Dentinogenesis imperfecta, malocclusion. I know that there's a separate session for that. Individuals can have hearing loss. They can have pulmonary abnormalities, muscle weakness, ligamentous laxity, as well as cardiovascular abnormalities. So OI is truly a multi-system disorder that not only affects the skeleton, but also the extraskeletal features. So because it's a systemic disorder, one of the questions are, what are the health concerns in adults with OI? There have been many systematic studies to address this. I will not be able to highlight all of those. I'm just going to highlight a couple of exemplars, and I'm sure many of you who are in the audience today have participated in studies like this. The first study I'm going to tell you is about the Adult Natural History Initiative that was led by Dr. Laura Tosi, who's on the panel today, and was initiated by the OIF. So this study was initiated to understand the health concerns in adults with OI, identify what gaps there are, and to assess some of the quality of life measures. This study collected detailed anthropometric, which means their height, weight, and OI-related clinical information, medical information, as well as participants filled out a questionnaire that would look at the outcome measurements for quality of health. So in this study, the individuals, not surprisingly, did report that they had a higher burden of fractures, fragile teeth, and hearing loss, all of which are clinical features of OI. But what we also got was that they had a higher proportion of refractory errors, a higher proportion of heartburn, as well as shortness of breath, again, alluding to the the pulmonary disease of the disorder. In addition to that, I see that someone is making marks on my slide. That is fine. Oh, wow. So I think the individual wants to say that high blood pressure may have been higher in individuals with OI. In this study, we did not, but there are other studies that show anecdotal reports that show that the high blood pressure may be higher in individuals with OI. Now, on quality of life, you can, as individuals with OI who categorize themselves as mild, moderate, and severe, you saw that those who categorize themselves as moderate and severe, not based on genetic testing or physician evaluation, but their self-categorization, they reported a decreased general physical health. And though individuals with OI, because of their resilience, did not end up reporting more pain, they had more pain interference in their reporting. The way to read this graph is the midline, or what would be the normal, would be around 50, and anything within this green shape would be normal. Something less than that or more than that would be abnormal. And again, as you see, the pain interference was an issue with individuals with OI. Again, similar to this, there have been many other systematic studies that have looked at the quality of life. The general theme of all these studies is that there seems to be a decreased physical component score in OI, which again, all of you have lived experiences of. Most of these large scale studies were done in Europe. And one of the things we did in North America as a part of the Brittle Bone Disorders Consortium, this is an NIH funded consortium, which studies OI in particular. And we have clinical sites across the United States, all of these listed here, along with the Montreal Shriners in Canada. And all of us collect data in a systematic manner. And here, one of the data that we collected was in the adults' health-related quality of life. We had over 300 individuals with OI, and we collected quality of life data on them. Chaya Murali, who's a clinical geneticist at Baylor, led this work for the Brittle Bone Disorders Consortium. And what we collected was numerous questionnaires, and we could construct a summary score, which told us two things. What are the physical functions in individuals with OI, and how are the mental components with individuals with OI? So our results again confirmed that the physical component scores are decreased in individuals with OI. The normal score is supposed to be around 50, around here. And as you see, those with the milder form of OI type 1 seem to have scores within the normal ranges, but the average or the median scores for those with type 3 and type 4 OI are below what would be normal. And these asterisks and the bars just show that this is statistically significant as well, just than by occurring by chance. But when you looked at the mental component scores, all the scores were well within normal limits. There are caveats to how this is calculated, but the overall message is that physical component scores are indeed decreased in the moderate to severe forms of OI. Now that we know that there is quality of life affected, what we need to look at is what are the skeletal issues with OI that can impact the quality of life, and what are the extraskeletal issues in adults with OI that impact the quality of life. So we'll just go over some of the skeletal issues, and here I'll also briefly talk about the medical therapy for bone fragility in OI. So I don't want to give a lecture to all of y'all on bone histology and bone structure, but if you were to look at a bone under a microscope, this is how it would look. You have the marrow here, and around the marrow, you would have the bone spicules, and then you have the thick bone or the cortical bone. If you were to take a higher magnification view, this is how the bone would look. You have a small canal system, and around that, you have bones in layers, and these are called the osteons. Now, in the bone, you see cells. These black sort of things are cells, and these cells come in three types. They're osteoblasts, which are bone-making cells, osteocytes, which are embedded in the bone, and they're important to sense how much pressure there is on the bone, and then you have osteoclasts, which are the bone-resorbing cells. Now, these cells end up putting a lot of bone matrix. Matrix is the scaffolding on which the bone cement is placed. And the matrix has an organic component and an inorganic component. And the organic component has type 1 collagen, which is the major protein inside the bone. And on that, you have the bone cement or the hydroxyapatite, the bone mineral that is plastered on. Now, type 1 collagen forms almost 90 to 95% of all the protein within the bone matrix. And the type 1 collagen is shown here. It's a complex helical structure. It's wound like the braids. And that is what gives these fibrils of collagen strength. And this is very important for the strength of the bone. Now, OI has abnormalities of type 1 collagen. There are other OIs which don't directly impact type 1 collagen, but the vast majority, 90 to 95%, are due to abnormalities of type 1 collagen. So when you have an abnormal type 1 collagen, what happens is that not only are the fibrils or the braids weaker, it also affects how the other proteins that have to dock on these fibrils, how they interact. It also affects how the cells within the proteins talk to each other. All of this alters the way the bone is made and the bone is resorbed, and that leads to a decreased bone mass and fractures, right? So a question often asked in the adult population is, what happens to fractures as we grow old? Is the fracture risk lower? What happens when women go through menopause or in older individuals? So one of the best data to answer this question comes from Dr. Folkstedt's study. This is a Danish registry study wherein, because of the way the health system is set up, you can look at the records at a population base. And as you see in both males that are depicted here and females, the fracture risks sort of go down into the adult years as compared to the pediatric years, with an increase around in the teen years. But after that, it gradually goes up during the older ages, especially in the women, and it stays there after their menopause. So this again shows that yes, individuals with OI tend to fracture less as they transition out of childhood into adulthood. But during the 40s and 50s, when other hormonal changes do take place, there is an increased risk, and this risk is sustained in women with osteogenesis imperfecta. Now, a question we can ask is, how do we reduce the fracture risk? And in order to do that, we need to understand a bit about bone remodeling. So the way new bone is made and the old bone is resorbed, so that the bone remains healthy and strong, is by remodeling, where an old bone is removed and you have new bone that is deposited in that space. So these cells called osteoclasts that I mentioned earlier come by and dig these small pits. They secrete digestive enzymes that take those bone and the matrix away, and they do these small pits. And then you have these cells called osteoblasts, or bone-forming cells, that come in and put new bone. So old bone is replaced by new bone. Now, whenever there's an imbalance about the bone being taken and the bone being put, you have an imbalance in the bone mass, and that's what happens in OI. So a way you can actually counteract that is you can either decrease the work of these cells called osteoclasts and decrease the resorption, or anti-resorptive therapy, or you can stimulate these cells to make more bone, and you promote bone anabolism, so that's anabolic therapy. So that is exactly what is now being done for OI. You have medications that decrease the resorption of the bone, and these include the bisphosphonates, which most of you are very well aware of. And there's a newer medication, denosumab, that is in clinical trials in children with OI, but this medication has been approved for osteoporosis in older individuals. Anabolic therapy stimulates the bone cells to make more bone, and you have teriparatide, a endogenous hormone that increases bone formation, and setrusumab, again, an antibody that mudlets bone. And this is now completed phase two trials, and now they're planning for phase three clinical trials. Now, while Dr. Cologio and his team, as well as others in the OI field, their work has shown, has led to bisphosphonates when it's becoming the standard of care in children with OI. However, in adults who don't have a growing skeleton, there are fewer studies in individuals with OI, and these are the studies that I've listed. Most of the design of the studies, the duration, and the type of OIs differ, but the general theme is bisphosphonates do increase the bone mineral density. However, fracture data are a bit harder to come by in the adults with OI with bisphosphonates. On a clinical basis, though, these are some of the common indications for bisphosphonates. If you have low or decreasing bone mineral density, if you have had recent fractures or increasing fractures over what your baseline is, or if there is significant bone pain, these are common indications. Some of the potential benefits of bisphosphonates include decreasing the bone turnover by decreasing the bone resorption. The bone mineral density goes up, and some studies have shown that they can also decrease the pain as well improve quality of life, though this has not been shown in every study. Now, you have oral bisphosphonates that you can take once a day, once a week, or even in other intervals. You have intravenous bisphosphonates that can be given with varying intervals, few months to every year. And which ones do you choose depends on a lot of other covariates that patients have, as well as how long they want to be treated. So this is something that you can discuss with your physicians. Now, denosumab has been tried in children, is still undergoing clinical investigation in children. It is not published in adults with OI, and most of the published evidence is limited to small case series, but there are no systematic randomized controlled trials. If you cannot tolerate bisphosphonates, your physicians may choose to go with denosumab, which is an approved medication for osteoporosis. Now, what about anabolic therapy, which doesn't act on the bone-eating cells, but on the bone-forming cells? And teriparatide has been approved by the FDA for treatment of osteoporosis, and it's not suitable for children. And I will go through quickly because I have a few other stuff to talk about. We did a clinical trial that showed that at least in those with a mild form of OI, teriparatide increases the bone density at the spine, but it doesn't do so much in those with moderate to severe individuals, and we do not have fracture data with the use of teriparatide in adults. In this study, it was not powered to detect the fracture change, and in that study, there was no change in the fracture. Dr. Glohue is leading anabolic therapy with citrusimab, and they have now completed a phase 2A trial, which shows that citrusimab increases the bone remodeling in OI, and a recent phase 2B, which is a more advanced study, has been completed, and the results have been made public by the sponsor, which shows that there was an increase in the bone mineral density, but the results are yet to be published. But now the company is now going into phase three trials. Now, those were the skeletal issues. I told you about basic bone biology. I told you what the fracture rates were and what the current strategies are for decreasing fracture risks. Now, what we need to also know is extraskeletal issues and what are the non-skeletal issues. And I'm just going to highlight three things: pulmonary disease, cardiovascular disease, and hearing loss. So again, from the Danish registry, Dr. Folkstad and others have shown that the average lifespan in individuals with OI on the overall average seems to be a bit lower than what is observed in the general population. And if you were to look at those disorders that were at a higher cause for the death in individuals with OI, those were diseases of the respiratory system as well as the digestive system. Now, pulmonary disease is a part of OI. This occurs not only because the chest wall and the bony abnormalities give less space for the lung to expand, but there also seems to be an intrinsic lung related issue in OI. And we have shown that individuals with type 3 OI, the more severe form, have significantly low lung volumes as shown here. So here you see the type 3 OI individuals in green, the type 4 in blue, and the type 1, the mildest one, in red. So you see that those with mild OI tend to have larger lung volumes than those with type 3 OI. So what generally is recommended is that those with compromised lung function do end up getting pneumococcal vaccine, do end up getting the annual influenza vaccine if there are no contraindications. And I know there's a COVID session that Dr. Sandhaus is going to chair tomorrow. You'll get a lot more information about that. But the MAC and most specialties would recommend that you get COVID-19 vaccine if there are no contraindications to the same. Now, cardiovascular disease, when the Danish registry data were looked into, there was a higher incidence of mitral valve insufficiency, a higher incidence for all-cause heart failure, as well as a certain rhythm disturbance with the heart called the atrial flutter. In my practice, I've not seen this, but this is a large registry. And so typically it is recommended that if you do have any abnormal clinical findings, you need to follow that with your physician and have a cardiological evaluation. Now, Dr. Vernick is on the faculty today, and he'll provide more information about this. If you have questions, hearing loss in OI occurs because of the bones that are required to conduct the sound from the external ear all the way to the internal ear here. The bones can just get broken, these small bones, or the foot plate of this bone that has to conduct the sound, that can get fixed. There are many studies of hearing loss in OI, and most studies were done in ENT departments, and so the patients they saw probably were those that had hearing loss. They had reported a higher percentage of hearing loss, as you would see, somewhere between 45 and 60. What the OIF and the Brittle Bone Disorders Consortium did, and this work was led by Karen McCall, a clinical geneticist at Baylor, is that we had 312 individuals on whom we saw the audiometry data, and we saw that there were 28% of individuals with OI have hearing loss. And again, as is well known, the hearing loss increases. The proportion of individuals with hearing loss increases with age, but most of the hearing loss can be treated with hearing aids, and Dr. Vernick can answer questions regarding surgical correction as well as cochlear implants if you have some. So finally, the last 2 minutes of the talk I want to take for transition of care and continuity of care in adults with OI. We had many questions, and this has been my experience as someone caring for individuals, adults with OI, that the care for adults is less centralized and less coordinated as compared to children. There are multiple factors for that. Again, may have to do with all the care for adults not being under one hospital. Providers may have limited experience in management with OI, and these are actual quotes from patients that I've heard, including my doctor thought I did not have OI because I went into the office walking. And adult hospitals may not be equipped to perform procedures and surgeries in adults with OI. So what can we do to facilitate coordination of care? Please have a primary physician who can establish a care team. This can be your geneticist, it can be your orthopedic specialist, it can be your primary care specialist, physician, or your endocrinologist. And make sure that you have a comprehensive review of things that are important, that are clinically important. Establish a team that can help coordinate the care. There are many resources that can help you take charge of your health, and I'm aware of more than one, but the one that I always go to is the OIF Adult care toolkit. So if you were to go on the OIF website, you can click on adult care, and you have numerous documents that will help, which you can take to your healthcare provider, or your healthcare provider can refer to while providing care for you. For example, if you were to go, it'll tell you what are the assessments that need to be done. And if you were to have a surgery, what does the anesthesiologist need to know, and so on and so forth. So I hope I've covered all four sections to tell you what the quality of life in adults with OI is, what the skeletal issues are, what the extra skeletal issues are, and what are some of the challenges and solutions for the transition of care. And I want to acknowledge that much of what I've learned is from patients, many of y'all who are on the site today. I want to thank our local skeletal dysplasia group of pediatric and adults, the OI Foundation, which is always our go-to resource. And I want to acknowledge the sources of our funding for the Brittle Bone Disorders Consortium, why the multiple institutes of NIH, which forms the basis for what we can do, of what we do. So thank you very much for listening to the talk, and I am happy to take any questions.
Thank you, Dr. Nagamani. So we did have several questions that came in ahead of time through the registration, but please continue to enter your questions in the chat and we will try to get to as many as possible. So starting off, we have some questions about aging. A lot of people are wondering that over 50, do they see increased tendon or muscle issues that might cause pain or weakness, or bone strength problems with age?
Do you want me to take this?
Sure.
So one of the things that I've noted in patients is that as they age, the back pain and the lower back pain increases significantly. And I've also seen patients who are going through perimenopausal or around the menopausal age who do tend to get more fractures. If the question is whether we do see an increase in dislocations, we see increase in joint-related issues, I have not seen any dislocations or laxity-related issues, more as individuals age, though in a few patients, they do have ankle instability and knee instability, for which I have referred them to physical medicine and rehabilitation and used soft braces to help them. I do not know of systematic data that shows that there is an increase in the tendon and ligament related issues.
Dr. Jain, do you want to add something?
Yeah, I was hoping to jump in. In my experience, I would say I do see a fair amount of tendon and joint related injury, particularly in adulthood. And it's something where, we do have some internal data that we're working on publishing, but it does suggest perhaps up to 80% of adults with a variety of forms of OI may experience chronic pain starting by age 30. I would say that when it comes to the types of pain that I see, some of it could be traced back to injuries in childhood, where perhaps there's a femur fracture, recurrent femur fractures leading to a leg length difference, which now over years to decades, the body has adapted to using a muscle that perhaps is not the ideal one for a specific activity like transitioning mobility or walking, let's say. So I would say that in my experience, I do see tendon and joint injuries in adulthood. I tell some of our patients that what I observe is that in childhood, OI is a primarily a disorder of bone, but in adulthood, it kind of transitions to more of a disorder of joint and muscle. Again, as Dr. Nagamani said, physical medicine is a go-to specialty that's a part of, should be a part of many of our patients' teams. And I would also say that, you know, I know that in speaking to a lot of adults with OI, there can be sometimes a negative viewpoint on physical therapy. What I would just say is that physical therapy is actually a mainstay of treatment. And I see it as an important lifelong therapy for an individual with OI to continue with. It's not uncommon that I'll see a patient who comes in their 40s or 50s without seeing an OI specialist, let's say for a couple of decades. And we often will have to recommend several rounds of physical therapy, focusing on different areas to kind of, try to address and be proactive when it comes to pain and muscle weakness.
Great, thank you. Actually, sticking with the physical therapy topic for you, Dr. Jain, we had a question about using common household chores as like a physical therapy. And what would be your thoughts or the rest of the panel's thoughts on repetitive actions and discs of the spine, not twisting, but just the, I guess, bending and reaching kind of motions?
Right. And so, you know, again, I would say in thinking about mobility and motion, it should be definitely individualized to an individual who has OI. In general, what I see is that core and hip weakness is a common feature in adults with OI. And I would be advocating for being active in the house, being active at home, really trying to do activities that focus on improving hip and core strength. Now, I would still recommend that this is done with the guidance perhaps of a physical therapist or physical medicine physician, just because, I would want, it's common for us to really, I'm not advocating, or it's not been my experience that I'd like to have patients see physical therapists for, every week for 10 years or something. But it's more that it's a few sessions and a home routine gets established. And part of that home routine should be activities of daily living, activities, chores that are done around the house. So I'd be seeking, dedicated, special, personalized advice when it comes to the household chores and activities.
Excellent. We also have a session tomorrow on fitness and OI, so I will post that link in the chat in just a moment. While I'm doing that, Dr. Sandhaus, are there any special considerations for a pulmonary nodule biopsy? In this case, specifically type 1, but also other types.
Well, there is a whole well-established routine for any individual who has a pulmonary nodule that needs to be worked up. And so the special considerations, though, for someone with OI have to do with the not so much the follow-up that's radiologic, but if it's adjudicated that the nodule needs to be biopsied, then the issues become procedural issues. And these kind of things relate to both doing sleep studies, to doing lung biopsies by bronchoscopy, things like that, and that you have to take into account the comfort and safety of an OI patient when you do those kinds of procedures. And as mentioned in an earlier presentation, patients with OI can have torturous tracheas. Their windpipe can be scrunched and curved and may be difficult to navigate someone's bronchial tubes to go out and take a little biopsy of a nodule. The good news is that the bronchoscopic procedures have gotten dramatically more accurate at reaching a lesion without causing harm to the patient. They're now done with GPS guidance, and there's even robotic bronchoscopy that's becoming more common. And I guess my concern, because there aren't that many OI patients that have had those kind of biopsies, is how well those more automated procedures actually take into account the differences in the lung anatomy of an OI patient compared to the general population. So it's good to have a pulmonologist or even orthopedists and generalists who are familiar with OI to consult with a pulmonologist who's working up a biopsy for a nodule. The good news is we're doing less biopsies on nodules than we have in the past, thanks to competent work that's been done following biopsies and their CT scan characteristics, so that we've learned that many nodules don't have to be biopsied. So make sure that you're being evaluated at a center that is up on the latest methods for evaluating things non-invasively before jumping into an invasive evaluation of a lung nodule.
Great, thank you so much. Dr. Tosi, I know that your expertise is on bone surgery.
Don't smoke.
Yes. We do have a question, though, that could you anticipate any complications from OI on cataract surgeries, or any of you?
I wouldn't dream of speaking to them.
Okay. Next question we have, Dr. Vernick, do we have a brief update on any of the latest on adult hearing loss issues or concerns?
There is very little new that has come out. There is a study that is showing some potential benefits of third generation bisphosphonates for hearing at least stabilization in adults. It's still pretty early and it's still very few numbers in the study, but it's the first study that's been done on bisphosphonates from the first to second, now the third generation, that may actually show some benefit, at least in the preliminary. So that's encouraging.
Great. Actually, sticking with you, Dr. Vernick, is vertigo a common thing for a common issue with people with OI?
I actually had to look up that because it is not a big issue from what I've seen in the literature, and it's not a big issue that I've encountered with the patients that I've dealt with. You can get vertigo just like any other adult can get vertigo, and it seems like the incidence is just about the same. The results of treatment are about the same, taking into some consideration as the limitations on people who have mobility issues and people who have strength issues in rehab and recovery from it. But the actual incidence of it, I couldn't find anything that pinpointed OI as increasing your incidence of problem.
Okay, thank you. Dr. Nagamani, we've had a few people ask about digestive issues and things like GERD or kidney stones. Have you seen a higher prevalence in those occurring in your adult with OI?
So I do note that the reflux seems to be an issue. And in the patients that I have seen, those individuals who have chest abnormalities and those who have limited mobility and use assisted devices, the incidence seems to be higher. And this is not surprising because, again, the sphincter or the valve that prevents the acid from the stomach to be leaked inside to the food pipe or the esophagus has to stay within the abdomen. And if you do have chest wall abnormalities and you're seated all the time, it is possible that this can just be nudged up into the thorax, and then you have the acid go up to the food pipe. I've had patients for whom we've had to treat with the anti-ulcer or the acid-reducing medications. These could be something like famotidine or the over-the-counter Prilosec or one of the acid reducers. And it does help. For a few individuals, it has been hard to take them off these medications, just because if you do that, they do complain of GERD that comes back, which impacts their daily activities. All I would say is that if you were to be on any acid-reducing medication, the calcium that you will take will, the formulation of calcium that you take is important. If you are on any of the acid-reducing medication, please make sure to take a calcium citrate that doesn't require so much of the stomach acidity to be absorbed. The more common form, the calcium carbonate that you take, it does not get absorbed when you're on acid-reducing medication. So one of the main GI problems that I've seen is the gastroesophageal reflux, or GERD.
Great, thank you so much. Dr. Tosi, moving to you, we have some questions about what do you recommend for compression fractures of the lumbar spine?
That's very tough, and it's pretty controversial, in fact. Clearly, it depends, is there more than one, did they occur recently, et cetera. In the child, we have the incredible opportunity that some of those fractures will reconstitute if we get them on to bisphosphonate and if they're young enough. In the adult, that's not an option. And issues come up. How unstable is the fracture? Does the fracture need to be stabilized? And all of those things need to be discussed with a real adult surgeon, spine surgeon, which I am not, but are certainly the source of great concern. And just to put in my biases early, I think the critical things are, one, you know, don't get up on ladders, and have other opportunities that might bring, let that happen. But also, you know, I do think we have to have our adults monitoring their bone very carefully. And I want to be the voice of Deb Krakow. Unless there is a compelling reason not to, we do feel that women at menopause should be on hormone replacement therapy, that estrogen is a really, really great drug for bone, and a great preserver of bone. And I think that the way to look at it is we have very little to offer once those fractures occur. Now, there is vertebroplasty and other efforts to blow up the bone. I have never seen that reported in OI. And again, it is controversial in the non-OI patient.
Wonderful, thank you so much. Moving on, we have some questions about vitamins, supplements, medications. Dr. Jain, have you seen any research that's done on vitamin K2 and OI?
So I'll say that I'm not aware of specific research when it comes to OI. It is well established, though, that you know, of course, vitamins are important for bone, and vitamin K2 appears to be one of them. But when it comes to is doing more vitamin K better for OI bone, I don't think that question has been answered. So Rather, my general recommendation is focused more on calcium and vitamin D. I am not that when it comes to vitamin K, I would, in general, I'm not against the treat, against taking extra, or I'm also not especially for it. So I don't think that it would hurt that much. And but I'm not aware of it having a benefit in
all. I agree.
If I may add to that, Dr. Jain, I have to look that up for OI. There's only one study that is ongoing in Europe that's only in children and adolescents, not in adults, with the vitamin K2.
Sticking with Dr. Nagamani, what age would you say is too late to start bisphosphonate treatment?
I don't think there's too late to start bisphosphonate treatment, because in the postmenopausal women, the many of the pivotal studies have been done in individuals who are in their 70s and early 80s. So if there, I do not think there is an upper bound limit for bisphosphonates. And I would probably say that with age, there is an increased risk of fracture as such. So if you do require bisphosphonates and your physician decides that there is low density and there's a higher risk for fracture, age per se, I don't think would be an issue.
Okay, and we have a follow-up question to that. I might butcher these names. Between frezolumumab and stressumab, what's the difference? And how would someone know which treatment is right for them once they're available?
Sure. So there. So let me take cetuximab first. So cetuximab, whenever you have a mab at the end of the medicine, it means that it is a monoclonal antibody. So it's a protein that goes and binds to something. So cetuximab is a monoclonal antibody that binds to something called sclerostin, and by inhibiting that, by binding to sclerostin, it takes away that inhibition that sclerostin has on the bone, and the bone formation increases. So cetuximab has been shown, at least in the initial phase 2 and 2B studies, to increase the bone mineral density both at the radius and at the vertebra, if I'm right. It's, the complete study is not still published. Now, it's still not approved. I would say that it would be another option for individuals with OI. A sister medication of cetuximab, which is called romosuzumab, has been approved for treatment in adults with osteoporosis. It's marketed out as Evenity. That's what cetuximab and romosuzumab do. They increase the signaling through a pathway called Wnt by taking off the inhibition and increase bone formation. Now, frezolumumab is a medication that is in initial studies and pretty early studies, and these are being conducted by the Brittle Bone Disorders, and I serve as a lead investigator for that. Now, what frezolumumab does is that it inhibits a particular protein called TGF-beta, and in the mouse models we have shown, as well as in human bones, we have shown that there's excess of this TGF-beta that alters the way the bone is made and being resorbed. So we are trying to inhibit this, and we think that the TGF-beta inhibition may not only be important for bone, but also for the lung. We don't have definitive data at larger number of humans, but they act on two very different things. When these become available, we'll know more information about which subset of individuals are more likely to benefit from one versus the other. Frezolumumab would not be recommended for someone with type 1 OI, at least as we currently know, but setrusumab actually is. So I think those are some of the differences I can point out to. I'm sorry if that was dense, but I was trying to make things up as I was going. So if you want me to summarize, setrusumab and frisolimumab act on two different things. Setrusumab acts on a normal bone pathway. Frisolimumab acts on a bone pathway that we think is much more activated in OI. Setrusumab may be effective even for mild and severe OI, while frisolimumab would be more effective for those with a more severe OI. Which one is better, we'll know once more studies come out.
Great, thank you so much. Moving on, Dr. Vernick, I know that you're a pulmonologist, but hoping that you'll be able to answer these. We have some cardiac questions. I'm sorry, not Dr. Vernick, Dr. Sandhaus. We have some cardiac questions. Specifically, in your opinion, could cardiac issues be caused by OI, especially weak valves? And do you know of any concerns that you would have with an open heart surgery with an individual with OI?
So there's a fairly extensive literature on cardiac issues in OI. As you might imagine or know, the valves of the heart are very type 1 collagen rich. But in addition to that, there can be compromises of the what we call the outflow tract of the heart, where the blood is leaving the ventricles and going out into the main vessels purely by the physical constriction of an altered chest architecture or pectus deformities of the breastbone. And so fortunately, valvular surgery has become more and more, or let's say less and less invasive, more and more safe. In OI patients, there's even valvular surgery that can be done without opening a chest or opening the heart. Depending on the valve, valves can be replaced or altered by an approach through the jugular vein, things along those lines. And so clearly there are concerns if a chest has to be opened, but there are a lot of ways of managing certain cardiac abnormalities with less invasive methodologies, especially in OI patients. It's important to go to a center that has experience with patients with OI, and that means going to a center with a big multidisciplinary approach to OI patients, if that's possible.
Great. Similar topic. Are there any OI adult preventative treatments for vascular and cardio health problems? I guess we'll stick with Dr. Sandhaus to start, and then Dr. Nagamani.
Yeah, maybe others have comments. I don't know if things that are specific. It's the most important thing is longitudinal evaluation of your cardiac and pulmonary function, because OI patients are different in the sense that measuring lung function and sometimes even measuring cardiac function can be affected by the distortions of the chest cavity. It's more important to look for change rather than some specific abnormality. And so to have baseline cardiac echoes, to have baseline pulmonary function tests that can be followed over time in an adult can greatly facilitate early identification of abnormalities should they occur.
Dr. Nagamani, did you have something to add?
Well, I completely agree with that. So there are cardiovascular preventative measures and cardiovascular measures, particularly for OI, right? For the preventative measures, I think general population screenings should be fine for hypertension, for lipid abnormalities, and those should be treated in concordance with the general recommendations. I have to say that in my experience, I have noted that individuals with OI who are fairly young also end up having hypertension. Now, some part of this elevated blood pressure may just be because of the pain response that they have, and some may be because of the blood pressure cuffs that are not the appropriate size, right? If we we use a large adult cuff versus a small cuff, the levels are different. So make sure that for cardiovascular screening, you tell your physicians about to use the right sort of cuff. There are recommendations as to how the cuff size should be in terms of the arm, as opposed to the arm size. In treatment for lipid abnormalities, for hypertension, taking a healthy diet, these are routine, but for the cardiovascular per se for OI, I do recommend, and again, this is not based out of evidence, this is my personal practice, I do recommend echo cardiogram, especially in those with the more severe forms. But as Dr. Sandhaus alluded to, we do get a fair amount of abnormal studies just because it was difficult to get the ultrasound because of the chest abnormalities, or when they normalize that to the body size, it comes out being abnormal. So longitudinal measurement is something that should be done.
Great. Actually, follow up to what you just said about the echoes. When do you think individuals should begin getting echoes and pulmonary function tests as like a baseline to develop?
I do that when they come in to establish care. If I do see that their pulmonary function volumes or the echo numbers are not within normal ranges, I go back to personally view the reports so that I know how they were normalized. And if there are any symptoms or if the imaging is not completely assuring, I do repeat them periodically, whether it's 1 year, whether it's every 3 years, whether it's every 5 years, that I think will be left to physician preferences. I do not think there is a recommended time interval, but I do it when they come in for their first sort of visit.
Thank you. Dr. Jain, what are some strategies or medications that you commonly or you have heard of are commonly used to help with everyday chronic pain?
Yeah, so, you know, I guess I see the treatment of chronic pain in adults with OI. Basically, I see three main pillars to that treatment. The first involves medicines. And I would say that my goal with medicines usually is that it's not something that is a, I'm not envisioning a lifelong medication for pain, but it's used for the time being while other strategies are being employed. You know, Dr. Nagamani mentioned bisphosphonates, which can help bone pain. We've had success with using a variety of medicine strategies such as muscle relaxers or NSAIDs, depending on the type of pain, whether trigger point injections or something along those lines might also be a benefit. I would also say that, you know, so that's the first pillar. Again, you know, it's something I see medicine treatment, treating with medication as something that's in sort of the short term. The other two areas that we focused on, and it's kind of taking a look at the chronic pain experience from a variety of conditions, including in the general population. But it is the second pillar being physical therapy and physical strengthening. It's very common that we see a vicious cycle where someone has an injury or a fracture or a surgery that leads to reduced activity, that leads to worsening pain, and we start seeing a spiral down. So a big part, where I see the biggest benefit, and you know, I mentioned physical therapy earlier, but it's really building physical endurance and muscle strength. The third pillar actually is trying to employ cognitive behavior strategies for pain. This can include strategies for that include mindfulness techniques where we can when there is pain, accepting the pain and not allowing it to spiral down out of control. Now, again, that's easier said than done and does take a lot of work with, you know, an expert. I'll also say that we do see, you know, using kind of these three broad areas, our hope, I think a treatment approach for an individual with OI who has chronic pain is similar to that in the general population, because using these three approaches is really what, you know, kind of the literature for the general population has demonstrated, where there's been demonstrated benefits. So there are lots of different strategies for chronic pain. Again, I would say it should be individualized. I do not envision medicines as the end all, but really just something that's there for us to use until we can work on things like endurance and learning perhaps coping strategies for individuals who would need it.
Great, thank you. Dr. Tosi, do you see a higher prevalence in hip and severe scoliosis in adults with OI than you do in the general population? Do you think the OI affects that?
I think this is where, you know, one of the big changes in OI is occurring. Although I will honestly tell you, I don't have the data to support it. The issue is that at least in my pediatric OI population, scoliosis has almost disappeared. And I think a lot of that has to do with the early providing of bisphosphonates. And so that the kids don't get micro compression fractures that then cascade and become scoliosis, not due to trunk weakness, but literally bone collapse. In the older patient, you know, for so many years, we really had very little to offer. Now with the pedicle screws, I think that surgery has become an option, but boy, you need to be sure the surgery is done by somebody who's done a lot in OI.
Great.
I'm not sure I fully answered your question, but it's another area where things are really changing.
And do you see a lot of joint pain and connective tissue injuries? And if so, do you have any treatment options, suggestions?
I would go back to Dr. Jain and his excellent suggestions, because I do think keeping the kids fit, it is interesting, at kids and adults. I had never had a patellar dislocation in OI, and I've had two in the
We seem to have lost Dr. Tosi.
Yes.
So we'll move on. actually, Dr. Jain, she did suggest you to take that one. Do you see an increase in joint pain and connective tissue injuries?
3 months. I'm going to start monitoring for that more closely with early PT.
Yeah, so I'll say that I do feel that in adulthood, that's what I primarily see, perhaps rather more often than fractures. And, you know, again, just to reiterate what I've been saying, I think a multidisciplinary and proactive approach is what's needed, because we don't want these injuries to linger and lead to the experience of chronic.
Right. Dr. Nagamani, we're going to switch topics a little bit here. It's a dental question. We do have a dental session happening on Sunday, and I'll post that link in the chat, but since you are part of the Brittle Bone Disorders Consortium, the question is it safe to use Invisalign to straighten teeth in OI individuals? Oh, you are muted, Dr. Nagamani.
Sorry about that. So let me first have a disclaimer. I don't think I'm qualified to answer that, but having known what is what are the ongoing studies. Invisalign, from what I understand, is a safer option because the traction and pull that is put by the clear aligners is a lot more gentle than the actual braces that tend to provide tugs at specific points. The Invisalign, they're apparently quite, they're more comfortable to wear, and they're trimmed to the gum line of the individuals, which makes it more comfortable to wear than having regular braces. And the, if you need more information regarding that, you can contact, you know, I think in the dental session, you should bring it up. But the overall message is Invisalign is a safer way of trying to manipulate the teeth as compared to the traditional braces.
Great. Actually, sticking with you, Dr. Nagamani, there was a question in the chat that Dr. Sandhaus answered a bit, but we'd like also to hear your thoughts. For atrial septal aneurysm, do you have a thought whether or not this could be related to OI and to the collagen?
Specifically an atrial septal aneurysm, you mean?
Correct.
No, I have not seen data that actually shows that there is a septal aneurysm in OI. There have, in the murine mouse, in the mouse models for OI, especially the more severe ones, there are data regarding valve leakiness and the overall function of the heart. Eric Rush, unfortunately, is not here today. He did a study on the echocardiographic features in children with OI, and I do not recollect higher incidence of atrial septal defect in there or a septal aneurysm. I have to look that up.
All right. We also had a question about carotid aneurysms in OI. Have you seen increased risk of carotid aneurysms?
I have not. And the only data that I know in adults with aneurysms come from the Folkstad Danish registry, wherein there was no statistically increased risk for aneurysms. Now, granted, they were going back from those who were admitted. So if they were asymptomatic aneurysms, either within the brain vasculature or the neck, we wouldn't get that. But there, I don't think there's published data to show that there are higher risk for all sorts of aneurysms within the in the OI population. Having said that, there are anecdotal reports, and if I recollect around about 10 to 12 publications on aortic aneurysms and increase of general, a larger size of the big vessel that goes from the heart, but on a larger population-based registry that has not panned out. If there is any concern for things like this, having the right sort of imaging and being referred to cardiology is something that I would definitely recommend, because there are, for things like this, it is rather, it's better to be safe than sorry, and being a bit more aggressive in detecting these would be important, even if it does mean that you have to get into the MRI machine or undergo a CT scan.
I have a question now for all of our panelists. I'd like to hear all of your individual takes. What would you say to a patient about the best preventative treatment plans for aging?
Don't age.
Let's start with you, Dr. Sandhaus.
You know, OI patients, as with many patients with rare conditions, have to be the experts in their disease. And attending conferences like this can really help with that. Many OI patients have to be the educators of their physicians rather than the recipients of their knowledge unless they're lucky enough to live at a near enough of a center that has a multidisciplinary approach to their management. I think that we're all wondering the best ways to avoid the effects of aging. I know that many physicians think of that don't have experience with OI think of OI as a children's disease, and they're always surprised when they meet a high functioning adult who's living their life normally with OI, so I don't know what specific things I would advise other than to keep up with what the latest that's going on in adult OI. You know, the push to have a specific focus on adults with OI, we really came from within the OI community itself. And I think that it was a very important step to start to essentially create a group of individuals with a focus on adult OI organ diseases like lung disease, et cetera. And I think that the community has taken the lead more than the clinicians have in terms of making sure that people focus on the adult with OI.
Thank you. Dr. Tosi, did you want to jump in on that?
Really, just to underscore what was said, I think that our worry based on our COVID survey is that over half of the respondents had reduced exercise due to COVID. And that's dangerous in terms of fracture risk, in terms of probably pulmonary function and everything else. And that investing in yourself with more exercise is the simplest and certainly the cheapest recommendation that we can make right now.
Dr. Nagamani, what about you?
Well, I think I would echo what has been done. I don't think there's a magic bullet for to prevent the effects of aging. But one thing I would also end up stressing is make sure that you get the screening that you would require on age-related based screening for cancer. If you're a woman, getting mammograms. If you're man or woman getting colonoscopies or the Cologuard now, those all have to be done. Keeping an active lifestyle as much as possible and keeping a healthy diet. Most of us tend to gain weight as we age because of the reduced activity. And that can be a significant burden on the joints and the weaker bones of individuals with OI. So I think increasing the physical activity, maintaining a healthy diet, and making sure that you're up to date with your screening are important for adults with OI. You're muted.
Dr. Jain, did you have anything that you wanted to add to that?
Yeah, I agree with everything that's been said, and I'll maybe just say it in a slightly different way. And so anecdotally, I've seen several adults who perhaps, adults with OI who perhaps may have ignored or overlooked an injury or pain or weakness, and just sort of, we all get busy in life. We all are busy doing our everyday activities. I would just encourage, our adults, adults with OI to continue to advocate and try to be proactive. So, while physical activity will be a good mainstay of general wellness, I do think that, something that I'll also say is that, as children, what I observe is that the recovery from injuries tends to be comparatively fairly quick. For adults with OI, please remember that, as anyone gets older, it does always take longer to heal as well. So to have those expectations set up from the beginning and give yourself the time that you would need to heal, let's say, from an injury.
Thank you. Thank you so much.
I have a public service announcement if you have that, because this might be the only time I have to say this. So since there's a fairly significant incidence of sleep apnea in adults with OI, the largest manufacturer of CPAP machines and BiPAP machines, Respironics, has announced essentially a total recall of all of its machines except the ones that were made in the last year. And they are trying to replace every single one of them. It apparently is millions of machines. So please, if you're on a CPAP machine made by Respironics, contact your pulmonologist or whoever's managing your sleep apnea, because you may need to either be switched to a different manufacturer's machine or arrange for a new Respironics machine when they're available, although they don't expect to be able to replace all of the defective machines for many years.
Thank you. That's good. Good to know. I'll just stick with you, Dr. Sandhaus, I believe. Can OI cause POTS due to weakened veins, in similar to the way that it does with Ehlers-Danlos?
I don't know the answer to that. I only know about Pott's disease from tuberculosis. Maybe one of the other doctors could answer that.
Dr. Nagamani?
POTS are this where you sort of have dizziness when you wake up, because some of the pooling of the blood is more so in the lower limbs. In my personal experience, I've not had any individuals with OI who actually complained of POTS higher than what we see in the general population, especially in the Ehlers-Danlos syndrome, especially the type 3, that seems to be a lot more prevalent. In my clinical experience, I've not seen a lot of individuals with POTS. Additionally, if you're sitting for a long time, it's harder for the blood to drain up. And if you do experience dizziness while you when you have this, what we would recommend is to make sure that you, before you stand up, you at least have some support and don't walk without support. And if you've been lying, if you've been standing up for a prolonged period of time and you get dizziness, you sit down. If this becomes recurrent, either trying to put compression stockings, or taking a medication that will end up increasing your, like Midodrine, which will prevent the POTS. These are available, but I've not seen in my practice a higher prevalence for POTS. And I don't know whether Dr. Jain has.
You know, I don't know about prevalence. I think maybe more anecdotally, I do have several patients who exhibit symptoms of POTS. A few have had testing with tilt table testing that confirmed that. So I don't know if it's a higher prevalence, but I definitely do have some patients who do have symptoms of POTS and confirm POTS. In keeping up with the general wellness theme, hydration is an important aspect of managing symptoms of POTS. In addition to what Dr. Nagamani has suggested, really honing in on hydration, if you're experiencing symptoms of POTS like dizziness with changes in position, would be something I would recommend as a first step.
Thank you. Dr. Tosi, regarding lower back pain, is it normal? Is there normally a disc issue or a sciatic nerve issue? And what do you recommend to help with that kind of pain?
Sorry, I needed to unmute. I don't think there's any data on that that has been focused on OI.
Dr. Tosi, you're very faint.
Okay. Is that better? better?
No, unfortunately.
Is that better?
No.
Is that better?
Nope.
All right.
I'm sorry, you'll need to move to someone else.
All right, we'll try you again in a little bit. Dr. Nagamani, have you seen a higher level of lower back pain, and do you think it ties to disc issues or sciatic nerve issues or other?
I have. And so first of all, I have to say that individuals with OI have a very high threshold for pain. And so when someone with this pain complains of it, I really take notice of it. And again, vertebral fractures that alter the curvature of the spine per se can affect the disc. And I've had patients with the disc-related disease, and the lower back pain, the proportion of individuals' lower back pain increases even in the general population with aging. And I've actually had patients with lower back pain, adults, where it has been incapacitating. So the things that I would do for individuals like that would be A, to figure out whether this is actually coming from the spine, whether it's a new vertebral fracture, whether that needs to be taken care of, or whether it's small bone pain, whether it's bone pain. And if it is bone pain related, I have treated individuals with bisphosphonates because at more frequent durations with lower doses, because that can affect bone pain. But for if it is not bone related pain and it's either disc related, especially if it is involving one of the nerves and they complain of shooting pain that's coming down their thighs all the way to their feet, then I will make sure to get imaging for those individuals and also refer them to physical medicine rehabilitation for back-related exercises. And for those individuals who do need pain control, I've had a couple of those, and I have had a few patients who've had to undergo epidural steroid injections just to control the pain.
Thank you. For people who are in a powered wheelchair with severe OI, how do you suggest that they stay active? And I'll give this to Dr. Jain.
Great. So I'll say that, you know, there are everyone with OI has different mobility and mobility options and how they can stay active. We've had success, I think, in a couple of areas for individuals who are non-ambulatory. One is the use of water, so aquatic activities. And, you know, when we're thinking about bone density, of course, weight bearing is best for bone strength. But when I'm thinking about improving muscle strength and trying to stay active in a way that's safe for the bone and joints in the water through aquatic therapy, we have had some success for adults who have severe OI. Another type of activity includes, you know, upper body activity. With the use of, you know, there are stationary bicycles for legs, but there are similar for the arms as well. So if we're working on cardiovascular conditioning, that could be an option. I do, you know, I would recommend though that while those are a couple of ideas, I do think that the plan should be individualized. So I'd recommend working with a physical therapist to really optimize the plan for you and your level of mobility.
Great. Dr. Nagamani, did you want to add something?
No, I think Dr. Jain covered it all.
Okay. So switching topics a little bit, we've heard mental health is something that we've heard a lot about this year. With the pandemic, and we heard about it in the research update this morning about the new pain and anxiety study in the BBDC. How do you address mental health concerns in your practice? Let's start with Dr. Nagamani.
I really did not want to be put on the spot for that.
Oh, sorry.
No. The reason I'm saying is because this is a huge challenge, whether you're getting appropriate mental health professionals to evaluate the logistics of this, the insurance-related issues with this, just makes it a lot more complicated. And as is available on the chat, the chronic people with many healthcare professionals may not realize the pain that is associated with OI and how this impacts. So I don't have bright ideas for this. What we do have is a group of mental health professionals. We have an active neuropsychology department. And again, as you referred to, one of the individuals leading the study for mental health in OI is also a clinical neuropsychologist. We tend to refer them, make appropriate referrals based on what it is that they have, whether it's anxiety, whether it's a mood disorder or a PTSD, and seek appropriate care. While that is simple to say, getting that care is completely different because there are logistic and financial barriers to getting that care.
Yeah, certainly it's definitely a big question, and I'm sorry to put you on the spot. I will say that we have Dr. Kara Ayers, who will be doing an Ask the Expert breakout room tomorrow morning during our Sunday update and Ask the Expert session. So we'll post that link in the chat and maybe we can get Dr. Ayers' opinion on. I'll give this to Dr. Jain. What is the best treatment strategy following a bisphosphonate holiday?
Again, I think that it is, this is individualized. So so bisphosphonate holiday, as many of you know, is taking time off of bisphosphonates. We know that in general, continuous use of bisphosphonates may have diminishing effects with time. So some providers will employ a holiday off of treatment. During that time, when treatment is stopped, I still advocate for adult patients to continue having yearly DEXA scans so we can help monitor to see what changes in bone density are occurring. In addition, I think trying to optimize and maximize physical activities is important. Bisphosphonates have a long half-life in the bone. So even when the infusions stop and slow down, they still may be active within bone. So it's going to be important to continue calcium and vitamin D supplementation that you had been while you were receiving infusions, even after those infusions have stopped. So those are my thoughts.
Great, thank you. As far as, we talked a little bit about scoliosis, Dr. Tosi touched on scoliosis a bit and how like in kids that she's treating, she's not seeing them as much anymore. But for an adult who already has some level of scoliosis, what can they do to prevent future decline? Dr. Nagamani, we'll start with you.
So the progression of scoliosis is not that rapid in adults as compared to children. The question is, what should you do in order to prevent the progression of scoliosis? The rate of scoliosis, especially in a skeleton that stopped growing, would be lower. Much of the problems would be during the younger ages. What can happen, though, is that if you were to have a scoliosis and you were to have a vertebral fracture in a in the right sort of orientation that accentuates that. That can give rise to either increased pain and or compromise. Other than routine bone health related measures, maintaining regular postures, I don't think there's any bright ideas I have regarding the scoliosis management. And Dr. Tosi, who does this for a living, probably may have better answers than I.
I'm Dallas Point Surgeon. Can you hear me okay, Melissa?
No, unfortunately, you're still very faint, Dr. Tosi.
I'll scream.
Oh, there you go.
Oh, dear. I think this is true whether you have OI or not. At this point in history, maintaining bone quality with good bone density probably helps prevent progression. But other than surgery, we do not have major treatment modalities at this point in time. As I alluded to earlier, the one piece of good news is if one does have to have surgery, the technology has improved incredibly, making it safer. You know, I'm so elderly that when I started out in orthopedics, they would put a hook up top, a hook at the bottom, and ratchet out the spine. That was not an option for people with osteogenesis imperfecta, to say the least. Now that they do it, I'm sure it's frightening to see, but they put a screw into what's called the pedicles at every level. They really can arrest curve progression and improve curves in ways we never dreamed of even 15 years ago. So that's the good news.
Great. We had a question of when people say that fracture risks increase with age, does that mean fractures that happen on their own with no motions or very normal motions, or fractures caused by falls? Let's go. Yep, I can remember.
Jain, do you want to take this?
I think Dr. Nagamani, why don't you go ahead?
Oh, you wanted me to take? I thought it was, okay. So the fracture risk increases with age. It's in the general population, it's mostly fall related, but the overall bone brittleness also increases, which just means that falling from a standing height, which should not end up causing a fracture in younger individuals, do cause that in the older individuals. In the OI population, I've had, many of you have brought it up, there's a cycle of one fracture, and then there are many that go through. And I've had them with and without trauma. There are individuals who've had trauma and break one and then have a cycle, and then there are individuals who are like, I didn't do much, all I did was just twist and then I broke a long bone. So I've seen increased risk both with trauma and without trauma as well. But the lesser you fall, the lesser is the risk. So I would say that with trauma is indeed a major driving factor, though what constitutes trauma just is different during the older ages.
Thank you. Dr. Jain, did you want to add to that? Or Dr. Tosi, I'm sorry.
I would just underscore that regardless, if you look someone who's 30, 40, 50, 60, 70, that they might have the same bone density score, but the risk of fracture.
Dr. Tosi, we're having trouble hearing you again.
So, and I think that's an incredible density.
density doesn't tell the whole quality of bone. It changes as we get to quiet. I'm sorry.
Thank you. Dr. Jain, did you want to add something?
Yeah, and I think, so I would just maybe echo what Dr. Tosi was saying, that, you know, the bone density measurement may be only part of the story. Risk of fracture with age happens both, I agree with what Dr. Mani said, with trauma, but also the fragility fractures perhaps can also increase with age. So I do think that, you know, while it is trauma related, I would say I definitely also do observe a fragile, I also observe an increased rate of what we'd call fragility.
Thank you. Dr. Jain, we'll stick with you. I think we touched on this a little bit earlier about the struggle with individuals with OI with stomach issues, but besides acid reflux, do you see additional digestive system issues, especially in more severe types?
And so, you know, I think that this is an issue that does keep me up at night. I'll say in the population of OI that I follow, we're noting a variety of different GI issues. And I wish, you know, I agree with what, you know, Dr. Nagamani presented and said, reflux tends to be a major one. Speaking more about the variety of diagnoses I've observed, I'll say that there can be issues with dysmotility. This can be motility issues where the stomach may slow down how it's emptying, slower transit through the intestines. There are also, you know, anecdotally, other diagnoses I've seen. I've seen irritable bowel type symptoms where there can be an alternating between diarrhea and constipation. And of course, you know, concerns with constipation, GI pain. In my experience, I would say that concerns with constipation and motility issues, I tend to see them more often in people with the more severe types of OI. It's not... you know, I think in thinking through it, some people, you know, one thought is, could it be that there is just a smaller area, smaller anatomy and less space, but still all of the intestines that are there. So could that be a contributing factor? Other thoughts are medicines. So it's not uncommon for adults with OI, particularly those who are experiencing chronic pain, to be on several different medications that can all have GI effects. So my comment, you know, on this is that I observe other gastrointestinal diagnoses. However, for a specific, you know, OI-wide treatment plan, that is lacking, and something that I know the foundation has their eye on. Our current practice is to get the the GI team involved. Although sometimes we're still navigating that, and that there's such a variety of gastrointestinal diagnoses we're seeing that it can often be challenging to get someone to the right specialist.
Thank you so much. Can somebody, I'd say, Dr. Gill, let's stick with you. Do you have I just lost my question. do you have any information? Actually, we're gonna switch to Dr. Nagamani. Sorry, do you have any information on the latest research on the links between OI and severe fatigue?
A link between OI and severe fatigue?
Correct.
I would say that fatigue and endurance are common complaints, and these may stem from either mobility-related issues, lung-related issues, the chronic pain that individuals have. I do not know if the question is whether I know of specific fatigue-related OI research. There are quality of life measures that do assess the overall fatigue and well-being. I can't remember the results at the top of the head, but the physical confidence scores were most commonly used one, which is the SF-36, does show that their fatigue and decreased endurance physical ability is a component of OI. I don't know that I answered the question. So the short answer is yes. The causes for fatigue in OI are the ones that I mentioned. And I think these are captured in the quality of life, health-related quality of life measures, both in the pediatric and adult populations.
Thank you. Dr. Sandhaus, have you noticed any higher occurrences of tachycardia in OI patients?
Well, we did in the studies that we've done at the Hospital for Special Surgery have a fair number of people with nonspecific tachycardia. So tachycardia is an increased heart rate, can be caused by many different things. We were mostly looking for, you know, atrial flutter and atrial fibrillation, which are specific medical conditions that have to do with the mechanism of transit of the signal that causes the heart to beat faster or slower, and didn't really see any, you know, in the small number of patients that we've evaluated, any particularly high incidence of those. So there are other reasons for tachycardia. Medications can cause tachycardia, especially medications that treat bronchospasm, like asthma-related medications. Any medication that has a kind of a stimulant in it can cause tachycardia, but not something specific. But I would actually turn to people like Sandesh and Dr. Jain, who have more experience with the general OI population to know whether that's an issue that they're dealing with on a more regular basis.
Dr. Jain, you want to take this first?
Yes, yeah, sure. I do have, you know, I'm just saying, I do have a handful of patients with different forms of tachycardia. I cannot say that I have seen a specific subtype that is more common in my experience. So I'll defer to you, Dr. Nagamani.
So there are two or three patients I distinctly remember who come with higher blood pressure. One of them blamed it, higher heart rate. One of them clearly blamed it on me, saying, I'm scared to come in because you're going to say something. But what I've typically noted is if they're in pain, with tachycardia is a pain response, I was unaware of any rhythm-related disturbances. But as I said, in the Danish registry, they did find that there was a higher incidence for atrial fibrillation. This is a tachycardia where the upper chambers of the heart beat pretty fast. And I do not know what the basis for that is, whether the electrical circuits get disorganized. I do not know that, but that's the only data that I know of increased tachycardia.
The times to be worried about tachycardia are if they occur sporadically. In other words, if your heartbeat is normal most of the time and then you have episodes of very fast heart rate, especially if that heart rate makes you feel faint or you pass out from it, or it causes changes in the how you're feeling that are distressing to you. Those are the things that would make you want to seek medical attention for that increased heart rate.
Yeah.
Thank you. Okay, and so as we approach the end of our time today, I have one last question, and I'm going to open it to each of you to take your turn on. But please remember that if you have any questions additional that we haven't had a chance to answer, you can always email us at bonelink@oif.org. We also still have our women's health session tomorrow afternoon, as well as the dental session, a mild OI forum, and the Ask the Experts, where you could get in one-on-one and have a conversation with our experts. Thank you all so much, just in advance, but we'll come to that again. So my last question here is, do you think a bone density test is helpful to know how strong or fragile bones are and to develop a baseline for your individual?
Oh, good, I don't have to answer that.
Let's start with Dr. Nagamani.
So the short answer is yes and no. And the yes, because that is one of the most commonly used measures as a surrogate for bone strength. But as Dr. Tosi did allude to in her previous response, bone density only reflects a part of the bone strength. So bone quality is not assessed. And also you have to look that bone density is a two-dimensional sort of picture. It does not give you a three-dimensional view of how well the bones are connected in between, how the cortical bone or the thick bone versus the trabecular bone, the thin bone are doing. And in many studies, if you look at the benefits of therapy and what proportion of the benefits of therapy are reflected by bone density, it only is around half. So in individuals with osteoporosis, if you were to look at what proportion of the risk reduction in fracture can be explained by bone density changes alone, it's around about 40% or so. 60% are because of things that the bone density does not capture. Now, there are better ways to assess bone density, just not using the common form is using DEXA, which is a two-dimensional view. There are now quantitative computed tomograms or QCTs, and certain centers have high-resolution peripheral QCT, which gives a lot more detail about bone. These are not clinically available at most sites. There, if you were to do those sort of tests, you can figure out, you can use mathematical algorithms to say what the changes in bone architecture, how they translate to bone strength. So the short answer is DEXA scan and bone density is useful because that's one of the most validated ones we have. It is definitely not perfect, and it can't tell you about bone quality. And there are other tests that are not widely available that may be a bit better than DEXA in assessing bone strength.
Melissa, can you hear me?
Yes, I can.
All right, that's a wonderful change. Yes, I couldn't agree more. It's an imperfect tool, but it's the best thing we've got. And the issue is tracking yourself across time. And there's a really important element to that. Unfortunately, the machines are not standardized. So once you get a DEXA somewhere, Timbuktu, keep going back to Timbuktu to get the follow-up one, because you cannot assume that the score you got on machine one relates in any way to the score you got on machine two. It's unfortunate. We have made, in partnership with the National Osteoporosis Foundation, efforts to try to get the machines to standardize, and we have failed to date.
Great. And actually, Dr. Sandhaus, I will put you on the spot on that. Because similarly, I know you have said in the past that pulmonary function tests are important to have as like a base to establish a baseline for yourself.
Right. I mean, we are plagued in pulmonary function testing by the fact that so much is dependent on normalizing the values. How do you look at a given value and figure out if that's normal for that individual? And in people with short stature, especially, the normals fall apart, since the major contributor to calculating a normal value is someone's height. We're working on ways to get around that in our pulmonary study. Right now, we're comparing, most of the time, most pulmonary function labs will use arm span as a surrogate for sight, but in people that have had rotting and multiple fractures in their upper extremities, that can be misleading. And the most interesting alternative we've come across as yet is point-to-point arm span, where you make a measurement from the tip of the finger to the wrist, to the elbow, to the shoulder, to the other shoulder, elbow, wrist, finger. And even that is very imperfect. And so we're left with, as I've emphasized before, not only the importance of looking at pulmonary function testing and other measures of lung function, such as oximetry, to look at oxygen levels and things like that, but the only way to be sure that things aren't changing for the worse, or whether the things that are being done are keeping you stable, is to have longitudinal testing, to get tested early. I could say early and often, but to get tested early and on a regular basis, and where you become your own comparator, to know whether things are going in the right direction. So I hope that the studies we're doing will give us even better ways of deciding on a given instance whether someone's lung function presents an issue or not. But in the meantime, the best we have is to have well done lung functioning function testing, usually at a pulmonary function lab at an academic facility or hospital, and to do that. And when I say often, I mean for an adult who's having issues with breathing, that would be doing that annually as a routine, and more frequently if things are changing.
Thank you. And we are at our time, but I did want to see if Dr. Vernick had a similar standard of test for hearing. You know, is there one that everyone should have like a baseline for?
For adults, I don't think it's as critical as it is for children. And most adults, if they're starting to have troubles, they're communicating with plenty of people around them who will remind them that they're not hearing what's going on, or they're having to turn up the TV, or they're having to ask people to repeat on a regular basis. And so those are the people that really should go in and have their hearing tested. And the problem with adults, and especially male adults, is that they don't really want to wear hearing aids, which is the usual answer for that problem. So I think that as soon as they start having trouble with hearing, is a good time to get tested. And then depending upon how severe it is, either yearly or every 2 or 3 years or 5 years, depending upon what their loss is.
Great, thank you. All right, thank you everyone. We we're so excited today that to have a live and translation available. We would love your feedback for the translation. If you could just fill out the poll before you go to let us know what language you listened in today. Thank you so much to our panelists and our presenters, Dr. Nagamani, Dr. Jain, Dr. Sandhaus, Dr. Vernick, and Dr. Tosi. We truly appreciate all your help and for being here on a Saturday. Thank you so much. We hope that everyone will join us. We have the adult social hour this evening, and we have a parents meet and greet this afternoon, and then tomorrow a full day of programming, which you can see at oif.org/virtualconference. Thank you all so much.